Well, hello, hello. It's a pleasure to be here once again in your screen, perhaps in your living room or on your phone, on your tablet or your computer. I'm glad to share with you this Bible study again. We are today on question number 53. Question number 53 of the Westminster Larger Catechism. I'm going to be going through the question, the answer, and all the biblical evidence that we have for that. Let us go straight away today. Let us go straight to the study. Let us pray. Let us pray and let us dive straight in. Blessed be your name, O Lord God Almighty. Teach us, O Lord, to fear your name. Teach us to love you. Teach us to consider your ways, O Lord. Teach us to consider your glory. Teach us the glory of your ascension. Teach us, O Lord, more about who you are, your love for us, what you have done, what you are doing, and what you will forever be doing for us, for your people. O Lord, may our hearts be, may they be pushed towards you, towards love, towards good deeds, towards the fear of the Lord, and towards the love of neighbor. We pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen. So question 53, how was Christ exalted in his ascension? The answer is quite long. However, half of this answer is all context. Half of this answer is just situating Christ in the moment of his ascension. The elements that show indeed and precisely how he was exalted in his ascension are mostly, or not mostly, all on the second half of this answer. So let us look, let us read the answer to the question, how was Christ exalted in his ascension? Here's the answer. Christ was exalted in his ascension in that having after his resurrection often appeared unto and conversed with his apostles, speaking to them of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God, and giving them commission to preach the gospel to all nations. 40 days after his resurrection, he, in our nature and as our head, triumphing over enemies, visibly went up into the highest heavens, there to receive gifts from men, to raise up our affections thither, and to prepare a place for us, where himself is, and shall continue till his second coming at the end of the world. Now, observe with me. Look at this. Look at how the answer begins. Christ was exalted in his ascension, in that having after his resurrection. That's not the answer yet. That's the context. So he was exalted in that. Now, after his resurrection, often appeared unto and conversed with his apostles, speaking to them of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. This is not the ascension yet, okay? It's just saying that after the resurrection, he appeared for 40 days, he conversed with the disciples, he did A, B, and C. This is not the ascension yet. And giving them commission to preach the gospel to all nations, this is not the ascension yet. This is the context. 40 days after his resurrection, he, in our nature, so this is the mode in which he was ascended into heaven. This is not the glory of the ascension in itself. This is the mode in which he did, which is in our nature, with a physical body, 100% human, 100% God as well, but 100% human. He, in our nation, and as our head, it was a representative. It was. That is already a little bit into the answer, how he was exalted in this, how he was glorified in this, is that he was being ascended into heaven in a matter that would represent how we, when I say we, I mean all those who are born again in Christ Jesus, we will go up into heaven one day. So the representativeness was already a glory in itself. The Bible calls this the first fruits. The first one to lead the line, to lead the kill, you know? Triumphing over enemies, once again, this is the mode, the fact that he was, that's already the exaltation itself. By being taken up to heaven, he displayed a triumph, a victory over all his enemies. So the answer, the real answer, is the second half of this. The first half is the context. So let us observe this. Christ was exalted in his ascension, in that having after his resurrection often appeared unto and conversed with his apostles, speaking to them of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. So let us see if this context is correct. Acts chapter 1, verses 2 and 3. Until the day in which he was taken up, so he indeed was taken up, after he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments to the apostles. So observe this. The answer said, he conversed with his apostles, and Acts says that he gave them plenty of commandments. So indeed, the answer, the Westminster Larger Catechism, it is correct in affirming this. Given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom he also presented himself alive after his suffering, by many infallible proofs. We're going to talk about these proofs. Being seen by them during 40 days. The answer here also mentioned that was 40 days. And speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God, exactly like the Westminster theologians composed the answer. So they copy and paste a lot of what was written in Acts chapter 1. So this is, once again, this is the context. He suffered, he was crucified, he died, he was buried, he rose on the third day. From the day of his resurrection until, from that day, 40 days onwards, he appeared and conversed and talked. He did not spend long times and slept with the disciples and had breakfast with them and lunch with them and dinner with them and slept with them again and traveled. Not like that. He appeared repeatedly. So it was, we had short periods in which they saw Christ. Some of these periods, they did not even know he was Christ. Like the disciples on the way to Emmaus. They did not know. They only realized after Jesus disappeared from their presence, and they realized, wasn't our heart burning within us as he spoke to us? Once again, that's yet again the proof of his resurrection. We see here by many infallible proofs. I think it was last Bible study that I mentioned that the resurrection of Christ is a historical fact. Not a theological point, it is also, but it is also a thing, an event that took place in human history, recorded. It's one of the most difficult things to deny in the world. Why? Let me tell you why. Number one, the amount of witnesses. If 500 people come to you and tell you, I've seen A, how do you deny that? How do you go about convincing 500 people that their eyes were wrong and that your speech is correct? How, let's say you saw Bob yesterday. How can I convince you that, no, you didn't see Bob? It was a figment of your imagination. You were daydreaming. Or maybe you went to bed with a lot of food in your belly and you had a dream. Or it was a delusion. Or just an image that appeared before you. Or maybe it was an angel. Now, one person is difficult enough. If somebody were to tell me, Felipe, I'm done with this Bible study, and somebody's want to tell me, Felipe, you were not speaking, looking at your phone with the numbers showing how many minutes I have recorded already. Or that, Felipe, you did not see all the books that you have behind you. You did not see that today. That person is going to have to work very hard to convince me that my memory is playing tricks on me. How do you do that to 400 people, 500 people? How do you manage that? Let me help you put things into perspective. Let's say we're gonna establish a court. We're going to hear all witnesses that claim to have seen Christ after the resurrection, one by one. We're going to give them one by one time, 15 minutes each, 15. Let's say we begin on breakfast on Monday. We wake up on Monday, that's the task for the week. We have breakfast and then we begin. One person, one by one, 15 minutes each. Do you know how when we would be done? We would be done on dinner time on Friday. That's the amount of people that the Bible records. Now observe, the Bible records these. The Bible doesn't say only these saw Christ. The Bible says, let's say you write a letter. John and I met Bob yesterday. Well, the letter is saying that two people saw Christ. But does that mean that only two saw? No. Maybe after we saw Bob, another billion people saw him on I don't know, walked around and saw him. A billion is too much, maybe, but a million. He climbed to the top of a building and he made a speech to a million people. That doesn't make what I said less true, that I and John saw Bob. So it is a list, but not an exhaustive list. It's a truthful list, but not an exhaustive one. So let us imagine that that list is exhaustive. It's complete. It's not. But let's say that's all that we have. Nobody else saw. Only those people. It's impossible to deny that. How are you going to convince 400, 500 people to believe your words and not their eyes? And not their very experience? How are you going to convince all those people that do not have a record of mental conditions that they were wrong? That their brains, all in the same time, played the same trick on them? How are you going to come in different days, different people, different scenarios? In one case, Jesus ate fish with them. Who brought the fish? Who ate the fish? Where did the fish go? Number one, the amount of witnesses. Number two, independent witnesses attested the report of the disciples. So it's not only 12, actually 11, because Judah had died, had committed suicide, and the number 12 did not take place yet. This would happen a few chapters later on the book of Acts. People that were outside of the circle of the 12 testified that they also saw. So somebody could say, Felipe, the disciples did not see. They came together and made a pact among themselves. They agreed with themselves to tell the same story. Well, how do you justify the independent witnesses, people that the disciples perhaps did not even know? In the sheer volume, you mean to tell me that the sheer that 400 people made a pact and not one of them budged on the end? That brings me to point number five. I'm going to skip to number five, then I'm going to go 3, 4, and then 6 and 7. They were tortured for that. The disciples were brutally, brutally persecuted and tortured. The Apostle Paul, that saw Christ in a vision, that Christ appeared to him after the resurrection. The Apostle Paul said, I am a witness of his resurrection because he appeared before me after the ascension. Think about that. It was not even during those 40 days. So the Apostle Paul, which was a man, financially speaking, very well off. The other day I saw somebody mention that some scholars believe that the Apostle Paul was able to communicate in more or less 70 different languages at that time. That's how well taught that man was. He was a leader among the Pharisees. Financially speaking, he was a man well off, very well respected. A man that had the praise of his own people for persecuting the church. And that man all of a sudden go nuts and think, you know what? I'm not going to persecute them anymore. I'm going to become the persecuted. I'm going to lose all my money. I'm going to lose all my prestige. The Apostle Paul said, we are a spectacle to the world. That's how ridiculously bad we are treated. We look like a spectacle. We look like a movie, a horror movie to the world. That's how you're suffering. So the Apostle Paul, that had all going on for him. Why would he change from that good, comfortable position to being persecuted? The man got beaten more times than he could count. I think it was 3-4 times that he got they call the quarentena in Portuguese, meaning 40, the 40. Beatings, it was 40 lashes minus one. They thought that 40 would kill somebody, so they did 39. He got that, I think, 3-4 times of, I don't know, 5. He was beaten, he was stoned, he was on a shipwreck, all because of the gospel. What makes such a clever, intelligent, well-educated, financially well-off man to give all away, to drop all that for the sake of beating, torture, prison? Why? Home prison, 2 years. He was in home prison, arrest. He was inside his own home, but he was still in a prison there. It was a home prison. Why? Why that? Because he believed in the resurrection. And you're going to tell me that's all a lie. Why? Furthermore, the independent witnesses also were tortured. People outside of the 12 were tortured for believing in the resurrection. The Apostle Paul, Stephen, the first martyr of the Christian church, killed with the agreement of the Apostle Paul. At that time, they were being killed. And these were people that were not of the 12. These were independent witnesses that were persecuted. So, witnesses, the Christians at large were being persecuted. Nobody was budging and saying, oh, you know what? Yeah, you guys got me. You know, please stop beating me. It was actually a lie. Jesus, he is quite dead. You know, he didn't resurrect. Nobody did that. Why? Why would they endure all of this? Oh, Felipe, you know, they made a pact. They would endure beating and suffering because of the prestige. Which prestige? You call being beaten 40 times minus 1 multiplied by 3, 4, 5 times? I don't remember now the amount. You call that prestige? They were a spectacle to the world. They were running away from their lives. These people were sleeping in caves. These people, I mean, never mind where they were going to the bathroom. Never mind how to find food. Never mind how to find a job. Never mind staying in a location where they were comfortable, where they knew people, where they had contacts, where they spoke the language. Never mind that. He said, I fail to see the prestige. That doesn't sound like prestige to me. That sounds like a nightmare. So, fishermen, they did not get a cent for that. They never became rich. Far from that. These people died poor. The only one that was not murdered, that was not martyred or murdered, was the Apostle John. And he died in exile in the island of Patmos. Where is the prestige? Where is the money? Where is the driving force that would make 12 disciples plus another 100, plus other hundreds to endure the most terrible torture for the sake of upholding a lie, a pact? What is the driving force behind that? What made them do that? Now, another thing that I find fascinating. People deny the resurrection today. We are 2,000 years, 1,900 something years from the resurrection. And today we're saying, no, it never happened. People at that time said it happened. So we are almost 2,000 years far from the event. And we claim to know more than the people that were actually there, that suffered for it, that upheld it, that wrote about it. No, but they are wrong, and we are right. Excuse me. So, and by the way, these are normal people. These were regular people. People that did not have a record. If one guy alone makes such an outrageous claim as resurrection, okay. And maybe the guy already had a history of mental instability. But no, these are regular fishermen, tax collectors. In order to be a tax collector, you cannot have a mental disturbances. You need to be sharp, otherwise people will not believe your accounting. In order to be a fisherman, at that time, fishermen were not only going fishing. They were fishing, they were establishing a business, they were building a network, they were selling. They had to communicate in other languages, in other dialects, so they could sell more, so their client base would be larger. That their livelihood depended on that. Now, if one of them had severe mental conditions, or if they suffered with hallucinations, would they be able to sustain that business? And those are the disciples only. Let alone four more witnesses, men, women, ladies, children, adults, old people, young people, a vast array of people to affirm it. How are we going to deny that? How is that not a historical fact? Oh, furthermore, so they did not have any financial gain. They did not attain fame. In one sense, they attained fame for being beaten. Oh, have you heard of the Peter? Yeah, he got a new beating today. Man, that man is famous. He gets a beating every other day. Yeah, that fame, yes, they did get it. That's not the fame you want. So all of this do not explain holding up a lie. Furthermore, not only they were preaching that, the mere belief on that would be highly discouraged. Let's say you hear today that Christians are preaching the gospel around and they are affirming the resurrection of Christ. And then you hear that the police officers are coming hard on the Christians and beating them and torturing them and arresting them and killing some of them. Would you even consider the possibility of believing in the resurrection? You'd be terrified. You tell your wife and your children, or your husband and your children, or your mom and dad, you're going to tell everybody that you know. Do not dream about believing that. Because look at what's happened to the people that claim. See, some of them may not even have said, I'm a Christian. They might have just said, I actually saw Jesus after he was killed. I don't know how to explain. All I know is that I saw the guy. That in itself, that alone was reason to put you in jail. So all the motivation in the world, severe motivation to not say it, and even more severe motivation to cause you to be quiet, to never preach it, to never go down that path. And we had hundreds of witnesses that affirmed it at the cost of their lives, well-being, finances, health. And today people say, I don't believe the resurrection. I'm sorry. It's far easier to prove the resurrection than to prove that Aristotle existed. Socrates, Plato, it's far easier. I think the writings that Plato did about Socrates, I think we have only six copies of their writings. And I don't think it's all about the same writing. So we have only six witnesses, so to speak, historical witnesses, written witnesses. The New Testament alone, only the New Testament. One group, I think Jesse Beatty, I think that's called the name. That's the name of the group of fragments that they have and copies of the New Testament. Something like 20 or 30,000. At that time, everybody was listening that Christ resurrected. How could such a faith and this amount of writings and documents and copies, how could this have spread so phenomenally well for the sake of a lie? And people are not crazy. The regular people were not crazy. They would read that and say, okay, is he resurrected? Well, that's a lie. He did it. We all know he did it. That would have, that faith, so to speak, that religion could have begun, but would have died as fast as it began. Maybe faster. Oh, Christianity is the largest religion in the world today, 2,000 years later. Many infallible proofs. Now, you see, the Bible doesn't say that you can prove that God existed. It doesn't say that. The Bible assumes the existence of God. The Bible presupposes the existence of God. Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God. So it's not justified, it's just accepted that he exists. So the Bible doesn't seek to prove God's existence. But the resurrection, the Bible says, there is proof. There is proof of the resurrection. If for us today it's impossible still to deny it, imagine for the people of the time. Imagine for the people that saw Christ. So that's the context. Let me continue from where we stopped on the answer here. And giving them commission to preach the gospel to all nations. So that Christ demanded that. Matthew chapter 28, verses 19-20. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son, and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Some people, clearly here, Jesus is saying, go and preach the gospel to all the nations. Some misguided people, let me repeat, some misguided, yet again, some very misguided people read this and say, Philippe, that's a task only for the disciples. The apostles were given the duty of preaching the gospel. We don't need to do that today. We just need to live the gospel and let the chips fall where they may. Spreading the gospel is a task of the disciples. Our task today is only to live the gospel. We don't need to be expansionists in terms of our faith. If people want to come, they come. But we don't need to be actively telling people to come to Christ. Now, first of all, that's unacceptable, biblically speaking. Let me read to you Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. This is what Christ said. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. If you want to play the argument, oh, this is only for the disciples. When Jesus said that they would receive the Holy Spirit, Jesus said only to the disciples. So if you want to enforce your argument, you also have to accept that the Holy Spirit was given only to the disciples. Can you see? You shall receive the power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me. So you're going to receive the Holy Spirit, and you're going to be my witnesses. One will lead to the other. That's the point. He's saying A will empower you to do B. If only the disciples have to preach, then you have to say that only the disciples received the Holy Spirit. Then you are also saying, by default, that you do not have the Holy Spirit. Now, how can you enter heaven if you don't have the Holy Spirit? Because Jesus also said, those who believe in me, I'll come and I'll live with him. I will be in his heart. I'll make in his heart my home. Of course, through the Holy Spirit. You want to say that it's not your task to preach the gospel. That's fine. Also admit that you don't have the Holy Spirit, and also admit that you're not a born-again Christian. Also admit that Jesus doesn't live in your heart. And by default, you're going to go to hell. I think you're going to lose. I think that you're getting the bad end of the deal. I'd rather admit that what Christ said, indeed, he was speaking to the disciples, but the task was given to all those who, like the disciples, received the task of the disciples, not by the lips of Christ alone. Now, if people say, oh, this was said only to the disciples. Well, I'm sorry, you're not that old, are you? You're not who are listening to me. You're not 2,000 years old, are you? So you are not there. So you know what? Maybe the whole Bible, nothing's for you then. Because you were not even born when any of this was written. Maybe the modern church should ditch the Bible. Because the modern church was not alive. Not around, not built, not nothing. When the whole Bible was written. Neither the first, neither the last page. So what? So it's a very silly, silly, silly argument. Very misguided. Let us continue. 40 days after his resurrection, guys, in case anybody's wondering where I'm at, I'm right here in the middle of the answer, okay? I'm continuing the answer. 40 days after his resurrection, he, in our nature and as our head, so eventually it says, visibly went up into the highest heaven. So he was elevated, he was ascended to heaven, visibly in our nature. Okay, so 40 days after his resurrection, he in our nature and as our head. Two matters here that I wanna that's quite important. As our head, in our nature. Let us look at these details. Reference 222. Hebrews 6:20. Where the forerunner, meaning the one going ahead, the one running in the front, where the forerunner has entered for us, even Jesus. So the forerunner is Jesus. He entered. Where is the place that he entered? He entered the Holy of Holies, the presence of the Lord. For us. That's representativity. He is our, when I say our, I mean those who are born again, representative. Not, he didn't do it just as he himself. That is Jesus, he did it by himself, for himself, to himself. It was a solitary matter. No. He was there as a representative. So the church, not talking about everybody, talking about the church, the born-again people, the real church, the invisible church, not all the human beings, not every human being, the church can say, when Christ did that, I was there in Christ. Whether or not I was born, whether or not I was alive at that time, whether or not I'm alive today, or whether or not... Or because maybe the new born again Christian will still be born, will still come to life. My point is church of the past, present, and future. Moses, who was a sinner like you and I, was there. I was not even born. I was there. David, he was there. Adam, the first Adam, which I believe was a born again man eventually, was represented in the second Adam. Entered for us, even Jesus, having become high priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. So as our head. Number one, in our nature, it says here, in our nature. This will be well demonstrated on other verses. So let us continue here, and I'll make the argument, the Bible verses will make the argument, that, and I will agree with it, that Christ ascended into heaven, not spiritually, but really physically. He himself, in his full being, ascended into heaven. The next one. Triumphing over enemies, reference 223. So let us read. Ephesians 4:8. Therefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts to men. Now, what is this captivity that he's taken captive? The greatest captivity that the Bible speaks of is the captivity of sin. But so he's saying, when he went to heaven, he is the one destroying sin instead of sin destroying him. The one who brings the captivity was himself taken captive. John Owen wrote a book called The Death of Death in the Death of Christ. In the exaltation, in the ascension, forgive me, Christ was affirming that yet again. Christ was glorying himself in the victory that he achieved in his death. So this death of death, this destruction of sin, this taking the captivity captive is all the same thing, just different ways to say the same thing. He triumphed over his enemies. That's what the answer mentions here. He triumphed over all those who wanted him dead. That were actually successful in killing. But eventually that success was canceled because he defeated death. So they thought they killed him, and indeed they did. But he became alive, undoing their works. Triumphing over enemies. He undid the work. Undid. I'm not sure if this word is correct. I know undone. I think undid is correct. He undid the work of the devil. Remember when Adam and Eve ate of the forbidden, the forbidden fruit, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? God promised to the serpent. God spoke to Adam first, Eve second, and then to the serpent, saying, "Her seed, the seed of the woman, which is Christ, eventually singular seed." Eve had plenty of children, but he said, "Her seed, singular. Her seed will crush your head. And you, serpent, you shall bruise his heel." His, not there. His, singular, his heel. So Christ, the seed of the woman, will crush the head of the serpent. What is crushing the head of somebody? It's destroying them. Destroying what they stand for. Destroying their done. This is destroying their completeness. So Christ did this. He undid. Forgive me if I'm making a horrible grammar mistake here. I ask for your apology. So he undid the bad work of the serpent, the work of sin. He triumphed over sin. Sin, death died in the death of Christ. Of course, the full extension of this will only be brought about on the final day, on the day of the resurrection of everybody. So he visibly, next one, visibly went up into the highest heavens. So when it says in our nature, it's also connected here to visibly. Went up into the highest heavens there to receive gifts for men. By his he was exalted in his ascension in a way that, because he, being a human, being a man, he was taken to glory. He was ascended. He was brought to the highest place. Indeed, Christ, Jesus is God, but he's also man. Now, that humanity was being exalted, not glorified, not deified. His divinity remained divine, obviously, and his humanity remained human, obviously. But that humanity was being glorified, was being taken to the highest heavens. So not only the second person of the Trinity, the Son. You cannot glorify God more than he's already glorified. You cannot increase the glory of God. God is God. You cannot expand the glory of one that has infinite glory. How do you expand infinity? It's impossible. It's illogical, actually, and therefore impossible. But Christ, the man, the person, Jesus, that man that died and rose again and was resurrected, that man is 100% human also. 100% God, but 100% human. So he was being glorified. Not ceasing to be man, but being glorified. And we see here on this reference here, Acts chapter 1, verse 9 until verse 11. Now, when he had spoken these things while they watched, the disciples were watching him, he was taken up, he was elevated, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, who also said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will so come in like manners as you saw him go into heaven." Let me remind you, they were looking, seeing, they saw Jesus. That Jesus that ate fish with them. That Jesus that said, take a look at my said, touch here, touch my hands, touch my feet. See that a spirit doesn't have flesh and bones like I have. Jesus said this. I have it. I'm human. indeed glorified. The doors were locked and Jesus appeared in the midst of them. Well, how does one does that? Well, how does one do that? Well, being glorified, glorified body. How does a glorified body really work? I don't know. I'll tell you in eternity. Ephesians 4:10. He who descended is also the one who ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. See, he who came down is the same one that went up. When Jesus came down, he was not a spirit coming to earth. A person came. Jesus came. He took flesh. He took humanity to himself. He brought that to himself. A person, flesh. So, if Jesus arose spiritually, as some claim, and I'll talk about that later, this is a very important question. Why the Bible so much emphasizes the fact that Jesus went up to heaven visibly and physically? Why? Because some people, misguided people, affirm that the ascension was not even a historical fact. Liberal Christians don't believe that. Maybe, and they say Jesus arose spiritually. Ephesians says, no. The one that came down is the one that went up. And Jesus came in flesh. Jesus Christ came in flesh. John said, here's the spirit of the Antichrist denies that Jesus came in flesh. And he said, the spirit of Christ, the one who has the spirit of Christ, the one who is of Christ, who say Jesus came in flesh. So the one that came is the one that went. So if he came in flesh, then he went up in flesh. Psalm 68 verse 18, you have ascended on high. You have led captivity captive. You have received gifts among men, even from the rebellious, that the Lord God might dwell there. Well, I have a few things to talk about this. Now, once again, why is it so important that we believe that he went physically up to heaven? Because the Bible says that, like I said, the one who came is the one who went. He came physically. If he went up to heaven physically, then he didn't come spiritually. If he went up spiritually, well, then the one that came was spiritual. Then the one that died on a cross was spiritual. Then, therefore, a spirit was crucified. Answer me this. How does a spirit die? How do you kill a spirit? Because see, dying in the Bible means the disjunction, this disconnection between body and soul. A spirit doesn't have a body. Jesus said, a spirit doesn't have bone and flesh like I have. So how does a spirit die? It doesn't. So if Jesus went up spiritually, that means that he came down spiritually. If he came down spiritually, he was only a spirit. If he was only a spirit, he didn't die, because a spirit cannot be killed. If he didn't die, then how are your sins justified? You see the problem? See the problem? Now, another matter. Why it's so important for us to believe, another reason why it's so important for us to believe that Jesus went up physically, because the angels said, men of Galilee, this same Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will soon come. So the one who went will come. There is I forgot the name of this sect, this group. They claim to be Christians. Now, the leader of this group, forgive me, I forgot the name. I learned from my history professor in seminary, but I forgot the name of the group. I beg your forgiveness. He claimed that Jesus would come back. And indeed, we believe that. But he said, Jesus is going to come back on such and such date. Oh, then we have a problem. Because Jesus said that belongs to the Father, the knowledge, the authority on that, and nobody knows. Nobody knows. And this man said, I did the math. I did the math and I found out, I figured it out when Jesus will come back. Jesus will come back on such and such a date. And then they gathered and Jesus did not come back. Do you know what he affirmed after that gathering? He said, oh no, Jesus did come. He came spiritually. Jesus returned spiritually. He came down to the temple, whatever he was, wherever he was. He said he came down spiritually. So he's with us spiritually. What a load of nonsense. Massive load of nonsense. Now, if Jesus went up spiritually and not physically, then he will not come down physically. Now, if Jesus went up spiritually only, then we will not be resurrected. We will have our spirits detached from our bodies. Because if a spirit is only the thing going up, why would Jesus resurrect you in order to take you up to heaven? Because the Bible says that Jesus is the forerunner. He's the first fruits of the dead, of those who sleep, meaning he's the first to come back from death, to be resurrected, to have a body, and to go up into heaven. If it's all spiritual, you have no hope of resurrection. You may claim that your spirit will be with Christ, which for many is already the case. The repentant thief that died beside Christ heard from Jesus, "Today you'll be with me in paradise." How? Spiritually. Physically? No. Physically, that Jesus is not dead yet. Jesus died, but is no longer dead. That repentant sinner, that repentant thief, well, he died all right. And let me tell you more, he's still dead. His spirit is with Christ, already enjoying the blessedness of Christ. But if Jesus went up to heaven spiritually, you have no hope of resurrection. Your only hope is that your spirit will be with Christ. We have a problem. We have a big problem in our hands. We affirm that Christ went up to heaven. Now you may say, "Philip, if he went up physically, why can't we not see him on the clouds? Why can't we, maybe some people traveling on airplanes should have saw him. Why don't we have pictures online of people, oh, there is Jesus on the clouds, and taking pictures of their phones from the windows of their airplanes?" Well, indeed, Jesus went to a physical body, and he said he went up to heaven. Cloud covered him. That is not to mean that he stood there. That's not to mean that he's there just flying. No, that's not the point. Heaven is on the Bible. Indeed, a cloud covered them from their eyes, but being taken up to heaven. Heaven, like I said before in previous studies, can mean three things on the Bible. There are abundant uses. There are abundant examples of these three uses of the word heaven. Heaven on the sense that the one where the clouds are, where you just go up, step out of your house and look up, there you go, you see heaven. Now number two, is the throne room of God, where God dwells. And the other one is the one that's called the spiritual regions, the celestial regions, where angels fight against demons and so on. So there are three kinds of heaven. We can affirm for sure that Jesus is not in the physical heaven right now, in the physical sky. He's not there right now. Otherwise, we'd have seen him already. So we affirm that. But Philip, you said he went physically. Then how can he be not in the place that we can see physically with our eyes? Well, he has a glorified body, doesn't he? Doesn't he? So what do I understand about that glorified body? It's a body that works on this earth. Once again, he ate fish here. And it's a body that works in the other realm, where he is right now, where Christ is. And the Bible says that he is preparing a place for us. Now, would that be applied to you now? Of course not. You don't have a glorified body yet. Christ has. So he has a body that can go to all these places. Now, you may say, "Philip, you're just making that stuff up." Well, obviously not. Obviously not. We can affirm with all confidence that the law of physics, as we know, doesn't really apply to the glorified body. And how would it? We don't have a glorified realm right now. This is a fallen realm. This is a realm where sin reigns. We have strict physical rules, physical laws for this realm, and they don't change. Now, indeed, when God makes a miracle, he He suspends that, those laws, but those are miracles. What Jesus did, was doing at that time, was a regular function of his glorified body. And he walked through walls. He appeared. He was invisible for a while. So indeed, we affirm the glorified body, something that we do not understand. Now, should I be making all these 100 different conjectures and thinking, oh, I think about this or maybe that? I don't know. Nobody has an experience of a glorified body apart from Christ himself. We don't know. That's why we affirm that he was taken physically to a spiritual place. Felipe, it looks like you're contradicting yourself. No, I'm not. All this is perfectly explained by the fact that his body is a different kind of body. But how? I don't know. I don't know how a glorified body works, and neither do you. Let me see from where do I continue. So, I wanted to talk about this importance of believing that Jesus went to a physical body, glorified, but physical, he physically ascended into heaven. We see here on Ephesians 4:10 that, on the end of Ephesians 4, verse 10, that he might feel, that he might feel all things. So what does this mean, that Jesus will feel all things? Remember, Jesus is God indeed, but he is a human. So it is normal for the Bible to use words that it looks like he is achieving at the higher stage. That, remember, the second person of the Trinity cannot be any higher. But Jesus as a person, Jesus, the person, Christ, 100% human, he can be glorified, and indeed he was. He was glorified in his ascension. So this is a spiritual affirmation that he was exalted, that he might feel all things. How exactly on detail? I don't know. I know that he received everything to be put under his control by his Father. How will he feel all things? Well, the second person of the Trinity was always everywhere. God is everywhere. Where is Jesus right now? I can affirm he's feeling all things. That's as much as I can go. Beyond that, I'm not comfortable going. I'm not comfortable saying things to you that I cannot be 100% confident. I know that he was exalted, glorified, and he feels all things now. My best explanation is that given his humanity, the Bible uses language to him that makes us think that his humanity was rising to a different level, not ceasing to be human, by no means. 100% human until right now, but an exalted person, a glorified human. And number three, we see Psalm 68, verse 18 says that he received gifts among men. Which gifts did he give to his church? What are the gifts that Jesus gave to his church? Ephesians answered this question. Ephesians chapter 4, verse verse 11 until verse 15 answered this question quite well. And he himself gave some to be apostles. See, on verse 10, it says, he who descended is also the one who ascended. So it's talking about the context here is affirming the one who came is the one that went up. So ascension here. He himself gave some to be apostles. See the gifts. Some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith. When are we going to come to the perfect unity of faith? And to the knowledge of the Son of God. When are we going to come to the full knowledge? Well, you are united in faith and you know Christ when you are converted. But that is fully implemented in the final day, in the day of our resurrection. So this distributing gifts among men is a giving of gifts so that some, not anymore today, are apostles. Some are evangelists. Some are pastors. Some are teachers. So Christ distributed gifts. Why? For the edifying of the saints, equipping of the saints for the work of ministry. So that we may preach the gospel well, so that we may believe the gospel well, so that we may understand it well. So Jesus was basically taking care of his church when he went up to heaven, so that he would give the gifts. How? Through the giving of the Holy Spirit. When he gave the Holy Spirit, Jesus said, you're going to receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you shall be my witnesses. So, the ascension of Christ, and he said, I have to go. If I don't go, the Spirit will not come. I have to go. So he came, Spirit, he went up, the Spirit came down to be with all those who love him and believe in him and live for him and adore him and want to die for him and want to live for him. To those, the Holy Spirit comes. Into those, the Holy Spirit comes and they receive gifts. Is that a Christian? Is that a born-again Christian without gifts? No. That doesn't exist. Okay? To raise up our affections thither, meaning to cause us to motivate our affections, to stir, to move, to push our affections thither, mean that place, to that location, to that place. So to cause our affections to be in heaven, to make us think about heaven, to cause us to be excited about heaven. Why? He is there. He is in heaven, preparing a place for us. He is there. So you ought to think. The Christian, the number one topic in Christian's mind should be Christ himself. Now, where is Christ? In heaven. So we ought to think about heaven. Look at reference 225. Colossians 3:1-2. If then you are raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is, sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth. Let's continue. And to prepare a place for us. To prepare a place for us. 226. If I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. He'll prepare a place for us. How is this preparation? Is he building stuff? Like, okay, this is the home. This is Bob's home. It's going to take me 3 months to build Bob's home. The angels are giving me a hand here, so. Yeah, we just finished a neighborhood with 1 million houses. And we're going to begin now another neighborhood for another 1 million houses. Is that building a place? Is Jesus right now putting the sink on your kitchen in heaven? What is this preparation? I don't know. I have no idea. I have no idea. I know that heaven is a physical place as well. Because another dimension, perhaps, I don't know. I know that Jesus went physically there. Jesus is there physically. But the Bible also says that he's at the right hand of God. And I know that it's a physical place and that he'll prepare a place so that I, with my physical body, can be with him. The Bible speaks of the new Jerusalem that will come down from heaven. And that will be the final heaven. It's a place where the Christians will be with God eternally, with Christ eternally. Here, coming down from heaven, so it will be here. In the new heaven and the new earth will be right here. Oh, the way things are now? No. The new Jerusalem will come down. The glory of God will come down. Christ will come down. And we will be with him, ruling forever and ever on this earth. Where he himself is and shall continue till his second coming at the end of the world. Acts 3:21, whom heaven must receive until the end, until the times of restoration of all things, which God has spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. Until his return, the day of Christ's return, the day of resurrection. The glorious days, the glorious day for the Christians and the horrible day for non-Christians. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we give thanks for your love and your blessing upon us. Lord, you went up to heaven, and our prayer now is, come. Lord Jesus, come. May we think more about you, Lord. May we think more about heaven. And Lord, we look forward to the day that heaven will be on earth. The new Jerusalem coming down from heaven. We look forward to that day, O Lord. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful day. Bye-bye.